reading from 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 14 through 19. Remind them of these things, charging them before God. Do not to fight about words. This is in no way profitable and leads to the ruin of the hearers. Be diligent to present yourself approved to God, a worker who doesn't need to be ashamed, correctly teaching the word of truth. But avoid arrogant, empty speech, for this will produce an even greater measure of godlessness, and their work will spread like gangrene. Himenaeus and Philetus are among them. They have deviated from the truth, saying that the resurrection has already taken place, and are overturning the faith of some. Nevertheless, God's solid foundation stands firm, and having this inscription, the Lord knows those who are his, and everyone who names the name of the Lord must turn away from unrighteousness.
Thank you. Happy St. Patrick's Day, and for those who got pinched, ouch! You know, it gave me a perfect reason to wear my green shirt this morning, and I'm glad of it. If I were to ask you this morning, how many friends do you have, what would you think I was thinking about? How many of you said Facebook in your mind? How many of you said, yeah. You know, I kind of like Facebook. I finally got on it lately because in order to get the church's sermons archived, I had to be on Facebook. So I got on Facebook, and it was amazing how many friends I quickly assimilated, and some of them I don't want. They're always sending me these ridiculous things that I just click off. But, you know, it is a good thing to have friends, isn't it? But that's not what I was asking you about, really. I was asking you how many personal friends you have. Now, a lot of you could probably do that on one hand, right? I mean, real personal friends. Now, we have casual friends, occasional friends, but personal friends. But then when I get down to that group that's in that, maybe that first five or that first 10, I ask myself, how many true friends do you have? How many true friends do you have? Living on this planet we call Earth, I believe there's, 7.7 billion people? So, you know, we run into each other every now and then. Occasionally, we do see people, and it's impossible for us to not meet human beings. Now, there are some people that are always looking for friends. They're trying to find a new friend or trying to find friends. There are others who are desperately looking for friends. I heard a joke about an old maid gal that was back in the congregation one day, and they told her that they said, you know, if you can really need a friend, would you jump up? And she said, any man available? You know, it's wonderful to have a lot of friends. As pastor and director of missions, I have met a host of people, a lot of good people, and yes, a few old soreheads. But you know, most of them, even a couple of the old soreheads, I even count as my friends because one of those soreheads was the best mechanic I have ever met. And boy, when my car didn't sound good, I called Jimmy and he'd say, bring her on down, preacher. Never asked to have to ask for a time to bring it, just bring her on down. But knowing that we were going to have this multitude of people, knowing that we were going to have to associate with each other, God has provided us with wisdom necessary in how to develop relationships. How many of you have read the book, How to Win Friends and Influence People? That used to be a college standard. You had to read that book. But God has given us some wisdom. He has helped us to avoid the pitfalls that too often destroy good friendship. As a portion, most of that portion of that wisdom is in the book of Proverbs. Now, I'm kind of familiar with the book of Proverbs. Anybody remember O.G. Lawless? When I came back here and started pastoring here in Bowling Green, he told me this. He said, Brother Bob, take care to read the book of Proverbs. Read a chapter every day. Now, when you start out reading a chapter every day, that means you've read the whole book of Proverbs in 1 month. And I did that for probably all the years I was out at Plano Baptist Church, so I'm very familiar with the book of Proverbs. Charles Lowry has referred to Proverbs as the bumper stickers of the Bible. Don't you just love reading bumper stickers? You know, some of them are so outrageous, they just make you kind of laugh, and I'm glad of that. Sometimes I want to cry at them, but anyway, the bumper stickers. There was another author who referred to Proverbs as the pithy sayings with a lot of power. Those little sayings that you read them and all of a sudden they hit you right they hit you right in the stomach, and you feel the power of those little sayings. Well, now this morning I want us to look at some godly advice to help us to understand friends. And if you'll notice, it says it, the value of a true friend, or value of friends, how to choose friends and how to maintain friends. And then, of course, the last one is my dearest friend. But the basic scripture that I'm going to use this morning for my sermon is Proverbs 18:24. A man who has friends must himself be friendly. And then notice, there is a friend that is closer to, who sticks closer than a brother. I'm going to use several scriptures today. In fact, my whole sermon is going to be based on scriptures from the book of Proverbs. And I thought at one time that I would just have you do Bible drills. I'd get you flipping from one passage to the other, and I know the kids would beat all of us. But I would. But then I decided that I would, I'd take pity on you, and I would put them on the board so that you can see them all. But one of the first things that Proverbs teaches us is the value of friends. Friends are the source of comfort in good times, and especially in bad. Proverbs 17:17 tells us, a friend loves at all times, and a brother is born in adversity. Now, I've known an awful lot of fair-weather friends. You know what I mean when I say fair-weather friends? Friends are there when you're good and nice, but then when you need them, where are they? They're nowhere to be found. It kind of reminds me of, of the parable of the prodigal son. You remember the prodigal son? Went into his dad, said, Dad, give me my inheritance. I want to go and I want to really live it up. Well, he did. As the Bible says, he had plenty of friends as long as he had what? Money. But did you notice that when he ended up in the pig pen, he didn't have anybody in the pig pen with him? Not one person was in that pig pen with that guy. But it is true. But this is a perfect example of Proverbs 19:4 that says, wealth makes many friends, but the poor is separated from their friends. As long as you got money, you got friends. But if you don't, you don't have friends. It's also an example of Proverbs 19:6. For every man is a friend who gives gifts. I tell you what, just go out and get you a bunch of gifts and start giving them away and see how they go. We see the perfect example of that on Halloween, don't we? When we have our trunk or treat here, I'm telling you, friends come out of every neighborhood and out of every house around to come to be because we're giving away gifts. But sometimes friends are more comfort than those provided by your brother. Proverbs 18:24 says, a man who has friends must be friendly, but he has a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. But this is further stressed in Proverbs 27:10, when it says, do not go to your brother's house when disaster strikes. Better a neighbor nearby than a brother far away. Most of you know that I was in service 9 years. My wife and I know what it's like to be there without a brother or sister or any family close by. And we learned that if we had friends like the people, the Bibies or the Busbies or the Smiths or the Gonzalez's, if we had friends like that, we could go to them and any time, any of the day, and we could find someone to talk to. They were all military brats, by the way. That's the reason I could talk to them. And not only that, but we had so many church friends. We had a wonderful church there in Tampa, Florida, and there in Fort Worth, Texas. And every one of our church members became our family. They became our family. We didn't have a brother or a father or a uncle or somebody to run to. So we had to run to their neighbor next by. Friends are a source of good comfort and counsel, and they can be a delight to our heart. And Proverbs 27:9 says, "And the sweetness of a man's friend gives delight by hearty counsel." I'm reminded of a chaplain in the Air Force. When I went back to the island of Guam, I came home at my mother's death and was here for about 15 to 20 days. I can't remember exactly. But when I went back, I was lower than a snake's belly. Anybody ever heard that statement? I was pretty low. I'd lost my mom, and I wasn't supposed to have to go back to Guam, but because they couldn't find a replacement, I had to go back there. And so I was kind of down in the dumps a little bit, I would say. But Chaplain Shepherd told me this. He said, "Bob, God will never place more on you than he knows that you can take." And I've had to rely on that statement over and over again since then. But he was such a wonderful counselor in that time of need and coming to my help. But then when I came back here, I just mentioned him a moment ago. Brother O.G. Lawless was director of missions when I took the first church out at Plano Baptist Church. And I'd never pastored a church. I didn't know what it was like to pastor a church. And I ran into a few difficult situations. And I said, going to Brother Lawless, "Brother Lawless, what do I do?" He said, "Bob, if you're going to be a pastor, you've got to develop the skin of a rhinoceros." I've counted on that a few times too during my ministry, to have the skin of a rhinoceros. The value of their counsel, though, is confirmed by Proverbs 11:14, when it states, "For the lack of guidance, a nation falls, but many counselors make victory." And then of 27:17, I love this one, "As iron sharpens iron, so a man sharpens the countenance of friends." You don't know how much I have been counseled and helped by people who just were wanting to be my friend and were wise enough to stay there even in the thick times and the then. But a friend who offers comfort and can be trusted to provide good counsel is a blessing. What a blessing. But Proverbs says you must also choose your friends carefully. In Proverbs 12:26, it states, "A righteous man is cautious about his friends." Why would he say that? Well, maybe it has to do with the friends you choose, the people that you choose to be your friend. He says, be careful with you. For something, here's the kind of friends we don't want. We don't want a friend who is a gossip. Proverbs 20:19 tells us, "He who goes about as a talebearer reveals secrets. Therefore, do not associate it with one who flatters you with their lips. It's awful good to hear people flatter you and pat you on the back, tell you what a good person you are, how great you are. But I tell you, sometimes that flattery just seems like it rolls like water off a duck's back, because it's not sincere. It's not sincere. "He who needs those, don't need those who are short-tempered and easily angered." Proverbs 22:24-25. "Make no friendship with an angry man, lest you learn his ways and set a snare for your soul." I grew up as a Martin. That's my last name, One of our traits was the Martin anger. My granddad was a man, he would get angry at the drop of the hat and he'd drop the hat. I've seen him get so angry at cattle sometimes, he kept a shotgun close by the dairy barn, had it loaded with rock salt. He'd get so mad at a cow that wouldn't do what he wanted to do, he'd let her out and then he'd shoot her with the shotgun. He was that type of angry. My wife will tell you, I probably have worked harder at this than anything else. Still don't do too good at it, but anyway, I try not to get easily angered. Then when we turn, we should spurn those who give in to drinking and gluttony. Well, Proverbs 23:20-21 states, "Do not join with those who drink too much wine or gorge themselves with meat, for drunkards and gluttons soon become poor quickly." If you've ever looked in the window of a liquor store, you understand that more than I do. I've never gone in to buy it, but those signs certainly tell the tale of how much. And if you've ever gone to the meat counter of your local grocery, you understand it too, because it's unbelievable. But we should always look with caution on those who are given to change. Do not join with the rebellious, for they will send sudden destruction upon you, and who knows the calamities they would bring. A person who rebellious is just not a person that you can count on. We definitely don't want to stay away from the, we want to stay away from those who are liars, who are untrustworthy, and who are inconsistent. Proverbs 25:18-19 says, "A man who bears false witness against his neighbor is like a club or a sword or sharp arrow." And if that wasn't bad enough, he says, "It's like a bad tooth." I don't know if you've ever had bad teeth, but boy, that kills you right there. Or a foot out of joint. I happen to be one of those that suffers from a few pains of gout. Guess where it always comes? In my right foot. And it's hard to put your foot on the ground when you're hurting from gout. And every time I read that, I say foot out of joint, foot with gout. That'll be the same thing. We certainly don't want to get involved with those who are given to violence. My son, it says in Proverbs 1:10-19, "My son, if sinners entice you, do not give over to them." And then he proceeds for 10 verses to tell him why not to give over to those who are violent. Now they said, "Come on, let's put our pot together. Let's put our bag together. Let's lay in wait. Let's get all that we can." But the writer of Proverbs says, you need to stay away from that type of people. Well, there are some friends that you definitely need to have, and those who display wisdom. In Proverbs 13:20, "He who walks with a wise man will be wise." Again, I'm going to go back to a man by the name of O.G. Lawless. That man was wise beyond wisdom. It was unbelievable how much I learned from that man. I was here for 5 years before I moved away. But I want to tell you what, I learned more in 5 years walking by this wise man than I learned in 3 years at the seminary. It was just a wonderful thing to walk by a wise man. Wisdom doesn't always come from those who are the best educated. Any of y'all found that out yet? Sometimes the best educated never let you use your own thoughts. They are always using their thoughts because they know better than you do. So, you know, you don't always get it from it. And then I've come to find out that in this day and era, common sense is just not very common these days, is it? Common sense is just not very common. Yeah. Certainly get involved with those. Okay. But we need that type of friendship. But also, we need to look at the wise who help to lead us in the right way. The Bible says in Proverbs 13:14, "The teaching of the wise is a fountain of life, turning a man from the snares of death." Wise men need to be heard. The wrong kind of friends can be a corrupting influence to you. But a friend who is good and wise is one that you need to grab onto and you need to hold to for life. Proverbs also gives us some good advice on how to remain friends. We know that if we're going to be a friend, there's some things that disturb friendships. For instance, we said a while ago we didn't like a gossip. Well, one thing you need to do is not be a gossip. Proverbs 17:19 says, "He who covers over an offense promotes love, but whosoever repeats the matter separates good friends." A talebearer, someone is a gossip. Reminds me of the story of Noah over in chapter 9 of the book of Genesis. Remember Noah, when he got off the ark, he planted him a vineyard. And he grew good grapes. He had some grapes there. And so he turned those grapes into wine. But Noah decided that he was consumed some of that wine. In fact, he consumed so much of that wine, he became drunk. And he went into his tent, and for some reason, being drunk causes you to do some strange things, I guess. But he went into his tent, and he laid down naked. Well, his son Ham happened to go into the tent, and one of the biblical admonitions is, do not look on your father's nakedness. That's a law in the book of Leviticus. Do not look on your... Well, of course, that law hadn't been given when Ham went in. But Ham went in and he saw his father's nakedness. Now, if he'd have kept it to himself, it would have been all right. But he runs out and tells his brother, guess what I saw? Well, Shem and Japheth, they heard what he said. But they took a cloth, put it on their backs, and then they backed into the tent, and they covered their father's nakedness without seeing him. You know that the rest of the time in the Old Testament, Ham and his descendants were cursed by what he did. We should avoid getting into senseless arguments. Proverbs 17:14, starting a quarrel is like breaching a dam, so drop the matter before the dispute breaks out. Any of you remember that story when we were children, was told about the little boy who saved his community by doing what? He stuck his finger in the dam. Boy, if in this day and age, if we don't need a lot of finger stickers, man, we need a lot of finger stickers. Be careful not to overstay your welcome. Proverbs 25:17 says, seldom set your foot in your neighbor's house lest he become worthy of you and hate you. Well, have you ever had that kind of neighbor? That every time they turned around, they were in your house? When we were pastor at Pleasant Hill Baptist Church in Campbellsville, we had a fantastic custodian. He was the nicest guy. He was just very friendly, overly friendly. He was just, he had this habit. Our parsonage was about as far as from here to Danny from the church. One driveway from the church. And our custodian had a way of just popping into our house unannounced. Never knocked. Never said, hey. Never gave us any warning. He just walked into our house. Needless to say, we never came downstairs unless we were fully dressed. Fully dressed. But the Bible tells us not to meddle in the affairs that are not our own. Proverbs 26:17 says, he who passes by and meddles in a quarrel that is not his own is like one who seizes a dog by his ears. Now you say, well, that's not bad. Now you got to think back now. We're not talking about domesticated dogs. We're not talking. We went to Joyce's sister's home yesterday, and when I started to get out of the car, I was greeted by a dog with two big paws right here. He just jumped right up on me. That's not the kind of dog I'm talking about. Although I don't think I'd have grabbed him by the ears either. But these were violent. These were wild dogs. And he says, don't, a person who meddles in an affair that's not his, it's like someone who go out and grab a wild dog by the ears. I don't think too many people are that brave. I don't think that they are that brave. But then he talks about practical jokers. Now, they can be funny. I don't mind. I like people who pick on me because I know they love me. Yes, Philip? I know they love me. But, you know, my father was a practical joker. Proverbs 26:18-19 says, like a madman who throws firebrands, arrows, and death is a man who deceives his neighbor, and he says to him, I was only joking. I was only joking. you had to be wary of my dad. I mean, it could be anything. I remember that there was a fellow who stoked the boiler at Borders Premier Company, and he had this chair that he set outside that when he stoked the boiler, he came out and sat in this chair. My dad drove 4 nails in that chair, let them stick up just a little bit, and then hooked a battery to it. I don't know whether you remember where Borders was, but it was right beside the open ditch there. I think it's a creek, they call it anyway, there. And when Dad hit that battery, that man liked to went in that creek. Didn't kill him, but if he'd had a weak heart, yes, it would have been bad. Then I can remember one time when we were playing crack the whip. Anybody know what that game is? Oh, I see a few of the older people here that said, yeah, I know what it is. You get a line of kids, and these were young teenage boys. You get a line of young teenage, and then you have someone who is strong at the very end. And my dad happens to be was stronger than all the teenage boys, and so he got at the end. And you start running down a hill, and all of a sudden, the one on the end stops. And then the rest of them have to try to come around with when he cracks the whip. But the only thing about it is when my dad got down to a certain place, he reached over and grabbed the coil of a Ford that was sitting there. Now, nobody got hurt but the guy on the end, and he thought he had been struck by lightning. That boy looked at my dad, and he said, if I could kill you, I would. I would. But we don't want to gossip as our friend, so be careful about our own tail-bearing. The Bible in 26:20 says, where there's no wood, the fire goes out. Where there's no tail-bearer, strife starts. You know, in our day of social media, this has become an overbearing burden for me. Every time I see what people put on social media, what the tail-bearing, and you know, we've had good examples of that lately in our newspaper and in our television. We need to worry about carrying tales, especially those that are false tales. False tales. Don't be contentious. As Proverbs 26:21 says, as charcoal is to burning coal and wood to fire, so is a contentious man. There's some people who just want to stir up trouble. I think we're in a world of them today. It seems like all over the place, people are wanting to stir up trouble. But if we could get rid of a few of those contentious people, maybe the trouble would go down. It's all right to compliment a person. I said a while ago, you'd like to have some people flatter you. But don't engage in insincere flattery. Proverbs 27:14 says, who blesses his friend with a loud voice rising early in the morning, it will be counted as a curse to him. Anything jump at you out of that passage of Scripture? It did me. Because my wife always says, when I start talking, people 2 blocks down can hear me. But this says, a loud voice. And then what else does it say? Early in the morning. I don't want anybody talking to me until I've had my coffee. Okay, whether it's loud or soft, I don't want anybody talking to me. But, you know, don't forget your forsake your friends. Proverbs 27:10 says, do not forsake your own friends or your father's friends. You know, many of my friends growing up were the friends of my enlarged family, extended family. And I was so glad for them. And some of them are still around. Roger Jones sitting back there, he's still, you know, he was around when I was a young whippersnapper and needed friends. And we had a gang, didn't we? Roger had about 5 or 6 or 7 boys that hung around together. Do you know I can count on all of those to be my friend? In fact, one of them was close to me when I was at Grappenburg Baptist Church. He's over at Lawrence, and he was a state trooper. So many times he got me out of trouble because he knew the state trooper. I had to drive from Grappenburg to Louisville to the hospital all the time. And I have a way of it once in a while of getting lead-footed. And I would look back and there'd be somebody behind me with the blue light. And he would drive up and he would say, "Well, I've caught you before. I've given you so many warnings, I've lost my warning pad. I'm going to have to fine you this time." But you know, it seemed like when I said something about, "Well, you know Don Powers? You know Don Powers? Oh yeah, he's my commanding officer." I said, "He and I grew up together." It's good to have friends, isn't it? It's good to have friends. If you follow this advice, you're not likely to offend your friends. But sometimes your best laid plans run astray. And sometimes, you know, you do have a little problem with your friends. But Proverbs, even offers you some help. For God knows that. In Proverbs 15:19, "An offended brother is more unyielding than a fortified city, and disputes are like the barbed gates of a citadel," and offers advice for, he offers advice for reclaiming the friendship. There is a way to solve the problem, and he gives us several ways. But the first way, I want you to listen to it carefully. Make sure you're at peace with the Lord. Make sure you're at peace with the Lord. Proverbs 16:7. "When a man's ways are pleasing to the Lord, he makes even his enemies live at peace with him." Isn't that marvelous? When you're at peace with the Lord, even your enemies live at peace with you. Make certain that you're slow to anger. Proverbs 15:18. "A hot-tempered man stirs up dissension, but a patient man calms a quarrel." Be slow to respond. Proverbs 18:13. "He who answers before listening, that is a folly and his shame." And you know, I read that and I thought, yeah. There's an old adage that says that's the reason God gave us two ears and one mouth. We're supposed to listen before we speak. Two ears and one mouth. But if we speak before we listen, we're going to get ourselves into trouble. Avoid quarreling in the first place. Proverbs 20:13. "It is to a man's honor to avoid strife, but every fool is quick to quarrel." So if you're one of those people that just can't wait to jump in there and quarrel with somebody, go ahead. What does the Bible call you? A fool. A fool. You don't want to be called a fool. Stand back and wait so that you'll have an opportunity to share. Learn to speak gently. Proverbs 15:1. "A gentle answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger." I don't believe that I ever heard my great-grandmother ever speak a word in anger. Now, it's not that we didn't make her angry at times. I mean, when she grew up with four kids and trying to take care of them while my mother worked, it was kind of a rough situation. But somehow, my granny, as we used to call her, she had a way of gently handling the situation. I wished I had that way. I wished I had gained that ability that she had to be able to speak in a way that would gently handle a situation. But this one here is one that some congregations, until I read it, I said, no, it doesn't work. Proverbs 10:19, "Learn to speak briefly. When words are many, sin is not absent, but he who holds his tongue is wise." You know, what is it James says? Oh, the tongue, it cannot be tamed. And it gets us into more trouble than it's worth at times. But he says, make sure, make certain that when we look at it, don't just use words. And then be quickly to show love. Proverbs 10:12. "Hatred stirs up dissension, but love covers all wrongs." Where have we heard that before? Where have we heard that? Anybody know 1 Corinthians 13? Where have we heard that before? "But if necessary, rebuke rather than flatter. Proverbs 28:23. He who rebukes a man will in the end gain more favor than he who flatters the tongue. You know, I found out that it's a true friend who knows it's going to hurt you if he tells you something. He knows it's going to be hard for you to take, but he tells you anyway. And it's, you know, you just, after you've gotten through the first little, you know, after you got through that, after you got that first little indication, you really think that that friend has hung the moon. They have really made it great. If we properly apply the wisdom of God that is found in his words, then we can be assured that we're going to enjoy the blessings of good friends in this life. And can also look forward to enjoying those friends in the eternal life. When we got ready to leave Pleasant Hill Baptist Church, they had a special service for us. It was kind of like one of these roast things where people told some good things and then some bad things about you while you were there. But I can remember one aspect of it that I broke down and I just had tears in my eyes. Joyce led the acting girls there. And so they got up to sing. They sung a song by Michael Smith. And in it, it said this: friends are friends forever if the Lord is Lord of them. And then the last part of that says, a lifetime's not too long to live as friends. Is it? Not too long. Rather than depend upon trial and error methods, we need to learn to win friends and influence people. We need to learn the Word of God and apply the Word of God. At the beginning of my sermon, I asked you how many friends you had. Some of you had a big bunch, some of you had a little bitty bunch. But then I asked you how many true friends you had, and boy, we brought them down, didn't we, to just a few. But let me ask you one final question. How many of those friends would die for you? How many of those friends would die for you? Did you hear in the Muslim shooting, this one guy saved a multitude of people by offering his own life, running at the gunman? How many of your friends would die for you? Well, let me ask you an even more serious question. How many of those friends would you die for? How many of those friends would you die for? Of all the friendships that could possibly develop, there's none more important than the one who sticks closer to you than a brother. That one is truly your friend, our Lord Jesus Christ. For the Bible says in John 15:13, greater love has no man than this, that he would lay down his life for his friends. That's what he did, didn't he? That's exactly what he did. He took the penalty that was mine. He took my sin, my guilt, my shortcomings. He took all of those things and he was willing to die for me. Paul over in Romans 5:6-8 states, for when we were still without strength in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man would one die, but perhaps for a good man someone would even die. But God demonstrated his love, his own love toward us, and that while we were, what? Still sinners, he died for us. We weren't good. We weren't righteous. Really, we weren't deserving, but that's what he did. He suffered the cruelest death possible to take the sentence that was meant for each one of us. He paid the ultimate price. In his death and his resurrection, it allows us to call him our friend. We can call Jesus our friend. We can call him our elder brother. We can call him. But let me ask you another question. Are you his friend? What makes you a friend of Jesus? The Bible is very clear about it. Over in John 15:14, it says, you are my friend if you do whatsoever I command you. That's how you become his friend. This means that to be his friend, you have to confess your sins. You have to repent of your sins. You have to call upon him for salvation. But that's not the end of it. If you're going to follow his commandments, then you must follow him in Christian baptism and in church membership. Now, I know some saying, well, I can be saved and not be baptized. That's right. You certainly can. You can be saved and not be baptized. But let me ask you this. Are you following his command? Are you following his command to be baptized? And then he said, well, I know you can. You don't have to go to church to be saved. That's right. You don't have to go to church to be saved. But I want to tell you this. If you're going to be his friend, you've got to follow him in what he died for. And Jesus died for the church. So think about that. He died for the church. If you confess him as Savior, he will confess you to be his Father in heaven. And the greatest friendship that you will ever know, the greatest friendship that you will have, will last for eternity, will be there. I want you to look at the first stanza of the hymn that we're going to use for our benediction. I think it's on the slide. And I want to read it while you read it. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to him in prayer. Do you have that kind of friend this morning? Do you have a friend that takes away your sin and takes away your griefs? He takes all of the things that bother you. And I love that word. He's the one that's going to give you peace. And only God can give you peace. You can't find it in a bottle. You can't find it in drugs. Really, you can't find it in personal friends. You can only find it in that one friend who will make it peace for you. You know, we can have that this morning. If you do not have it, you can if you turn to him and give your life over to him. I want to ask you to stand this morning as Brother Aaron comes to lead us in that invitational hymn. It is What a Friend We Have in Jesus. And as you sing it, I want you to ask yourself, is he my friend? And then the second question, am I his friend? Let's pray together. Lord, we don't have a friend like you here on this earth. For if all of our friends that we think we have and all the friends that we thought we might be a part of, if they were to forsake us, we know we have a friend that is closer than our brother. We have a friend that was willing to die for us while we're just sinners. And Father, we have a friend that we can talk to every day, no matter what troubles or trials we're having, no matter how difficult the situation, we have a friend that has a listening ear. We have a friend that's interceding for us in heaven. And Lord, we just pray today, if there's one here that's never given their heart and life over to that wonderful friend, we pray that they'll do it this morning. For we offer this invitation in the name of him who died for us. Amen.
What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. Trials and temptations.